At Fermilab, we study nature at its most fundamental, drilling down to the smallest scales of matter using some of the largest and most advanced machines in the world. Accelerators, powerful microscopes, send particles barreling at near light speed into other matter, creating subatomic scraps. Detectors zoom in on those fleeting pieces, making the invisible perceptible. And sophisticated computers sweep through all of it, crushing mountains of information into gems of data. We also use our cutting-edge technology to explore the mysteries of dark matter and the quantum realm. Thousands of scientists from around the world partner with Fermilab to explore how the universe works, expanding humanity's understanding of matter, energy, space, and time. Fermilab is solving the mysteries of the universe.
Thank you all for coming to Fermilab's virtual open house. We are here for the stargazing, a view of the night sky. We have Julie Albert here, who is an education facilitator at Fermilab, and she will be talking about the constellations and how you look at the night sky. And then we also have Donna Kubik here, who is an engineering physicist at Fermilab, who will actually take you to the South Pole, where she did some work. And so we're excited to have you all here. Let's take it away.
Hi, my name is Julie Albert, and I'm an educator facilitator at Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory. Welcome to Stargazing, View the Night Sky. We will learn to make a constellation viewer and star wheel and see what scientists use to study outer space. Have you ever looked up at a star-filled sky? The expanse of stars in a clear night sky is truly an amazing sight. The stars are so numerous, it would be very hard to count them all. As you look at these stars, you may be asking yourself, just what is a star? Stars are huge, hot balls of flaming gas. Stars give off enormous amounts of heat and light. And stars vary in size and temperature. Stars are not just white, they are many different colors. Our sun is a yellow star. Some stars can last for billions of years before running out of fuel. Why do stars in the night sky look like tiny dots? You're right. They are very far away. Scientists who study outer space and everything in it are called astronomers. One famous astronomer was Edwin Hubble. What is he doing? Let's find out. When Edwin Hubble was young, he loved to read stories about space travelers. He was fascinated by the night sky. Using a large telescope like this, Hubble discovered that there were other galaxies in the universe, not just our Milky Way galaxy, and that they were moving away from each other. The Hubble Space Telescope, launched in 1990, is named after him. Edwin Hubble was curious about outer space. Maybe you are too. Hubble used a telescope to learn more about the stars and our universe, but people have been fascinated by the night sky for thousands of years. Long before the telescope was invented, they noticed that some stars were clustered together and formed patterns called constellations. When they looked at the constellations, they imagined they formed the shapes of people, objects, or animals. Here you see pictures of those imaginary shapes on this very cool constellation globe.
peoples of different cultures saw different shapes in the clusters of stars, shapes that were familiar to them. They made up their own stories about the star patterns they saw. Today, there are 88 official constellations, and all 88 are pictured on this constellation globe. More than half of the official constellations come from the ancient Greeks. Now, we cannot see all the constellations from one place. For those of us that live in the northern part of the Earth, or the northern hemisphere, we can only see stars in that area of the sky. For those who live in the southern half of the Earth, or in the southern hemisphere, they will see different constellations because they are viewing a different part of the sky.
Let's take a look at one of the constellations found in the northern hemisphere sky, Ursa Major. This is one of the largest constellations. Its name, Ursa Major, means Great Bear. The ancient Greeks imagined this cluster of stars looked like a large bear with a long tail. This is how that bear shape might look. It's an outline going around the stars in the constellation. Not all the stars in the Ursa Major constellation are as equally as bright. The brightest group of stars in the constellation is called the Big Dipper, because it looks like a cup with a long handle. It can be found in the sky every clear night. Looking again at the Ursa Major constellation, can you see the Big Dipper? Yes. It is near the back of the bear, with the handle forming the tail. When viewing the Big Dipper in the night sky, it may look like the stars are close together. However, they are very far apart, and they are also different distances from Earth. That is true for all stars. The Big Dipper is seen here with another group of stars called the Little Dipper. The Little Dipper is part of the Ursa Minor, or Little Bear, constellation. An important star is part of the Little Dipper. The arrow is pointing to it, the last star in the handle of the Little Dipper. It is Polaris, or the North Star. To find the North Star in the night sky, look for the last two stars that make up the cup of the Big Dipper. These are the pointer stars. Trace a line through these stars and continue in a straight line. This will lead you to the North Star. While the North Star is not one of the brightest stars in the sky, it is useful to be able to locate it. This star never seems to move and can always be found in the northern sky. Now we are ready for the first activity.
To help you become familiar with some of the more common constellations, we will make a constellation viewer. If you do not have the materials for this activity or for the second activity, that's okay. Just watch, and when you do get the materials, you will know how to make the constellation viewer and star wheel. For the constellation viewer, you will need the printed constellation sheet, a piece of black paper about 5 inches square, piece of cardboard, toilet paper tube, glue stick, rubber band, push pin or straight pin, and scissors. So we'll cut out the Ursa Major constellation, the one we talked about. It's in the upper right-hand corner of your sheet. Inside the circle is the Big Dipper star pattern, the brightest stars in that constellation. We will cut along the dotted lines, and we want to include the name at the bottom. So let's take our scissors and we'll start cutting. And remember, we're cutting on the dotted line. Dotted line to finish cutting out the circle. We're going to take our shape and turn it over, taking our glue stick. We're going to spread glue on the back of the shape. And we want to glue the circle to the center of our black paper. And if it's not straight, that's okay. That doesn't matter. We're going to place our black paper on top of our piece of cardboard. And using our push pin, we will poke holes through the star dots. And make sure the point of the pin goes through the white paper and the black paper. So a constellation is like a dot-to-dot picture, where the stars are the dots. We now want to center the white circle over the open end of our toilet paper tube. So get it right over the opening and then fold the black paper down around the tube. So you'll be folding the black paper over on itself in several spots. And then taking your rubber band, we're going to go over the top of the tube to hold that paper in place. And now your viewer is ready to use. So hold the viewer up to your eye and look down the tube. And you should see what the Big Dipper looks like in the night sky. If you slowly turn your tube, you will see the Big Dipper changes position, just as it does in the night sky throughout the year. To view other constellations, you simply need to cut those out, glue them onto a piece of black paper, poke the holes in the star dots, and then take off the Ursa Major paper and put on the new constellation. Or, if you have several toilet paper tubes, you can make separate viewers for each constellation. Once you become familiar with the various constellation patterns, you will want to find them in the night sky. To help you do that, we'll make a star wheel. So we will need a stapler, scissors, and two printed sheets. The circular sky map and the star wheel holder. I will be using the sheets for the Northern Hemisphere. The first thing we're going to do is to cut out our circular sky map. And we'll cut along the edge of the circle. So take your scissors and we'll start cutting. So I'm noticing, as I'm turning my paper, the different months of the year along the edge of the circle. So So to go around the circle once represents 1 year. I'm also noticing, as I'm turning my paper, that different constellations come into view. Most of the constellations are only visible at certain times of the year. When cutting out our star wheel holder, it's important to remember to include the white rectangle at the bottom. It is part of the holder. So I'm going to start cutting up from the bottom of the paper on that black line and up along the shaded portion of the holder. Now, when you're choosing a night to go out to stargaze, there's several things you need to think about. It must be a very clear night. No clouds in the sky is best. It should also be very dark. So you will have to wait some time after sunset before you can do your stargazing. And when you do go out, give your eyes plenty of time to adjust to the dark. That way, you'll see more stars. We have one more cutting, and that is the white oval. So I'm going to turn my holder over and hold both ends in my hand that I do not use for cutting. Turn my paper over and in the center of the oval, give a pinch. And on that crease, I'm going to make a cut. So when we open our paper flat, there's now an opening for our scissors and we can cut over to the edge of the oval. And then cut around the oval. Another thing you need to think about when choosing a good night to stargaze is the light of from the moon. That light is very bright and it washes out the light from the stars. So you should choose a night with very little moonlight or no moonlight at all. So now we have our star wheel holder cut out with the white rectangle at the bottom and the oval cut out. I'm going to let's turn our star wheel over, and we're going to fold up the white rectangle at the bottom of the holder. So I'm going to pull it up so I see the black line, and then fold and crease along that line. Turn your holder over, and we're going to staple the white rectangle to the front of the holder. Notice the two short white lines on either side. Those are your staple lines. So using your stapler, staple one side and then staple the other side. We now created a pocket to hold our star wheel. So insert the star wheel into the holder. And that's it. Now you can make your Holder and circular sky map more durable by gluing them onto separate pieces of heavier paper. So let's take a look at the information on our star wheel. Around the edge of the oval, we see directions facing south, west, north, and east. So when you're using your star wheel outside, you need to know which direction you are facing. If you're not sure, I'm sure someone is there to help you. Along the edge of the holder, we see times. The upper time is for standard time, which for many of us is the late fall and winter. The lower time is daylight saving time, and that's during the spring, summer, and early fall. On the edge of the circular sky map, we see the months and the days of the month. And what you see in the oval is the full night sky for a particular date and time. The stars at the bottom of the oval are the stars along the horizon. The horizon is where the sky meets the earth. So those stars will be straight in front of you. The stars further up in the oval will be higher in the sky. And the stars in the center will be directly overhead. To see the stars above the oval, you will have to turn around because they are behind you. So you would, if we're facing south, you would have to turn and face north, turn your star wheel around so you read facing north, and then these are the stars you will see. The ones low in the oval near the bottom will be along the horizon. The stars farther up will be higher in the sky, and the same stars will be overhead. So let's turn our star wheel around. And when you're outside viewing at night, you need to hold your star wheel up in front of you, as pictured in the lower right-hand corner. It's very important to use your star map that way. To see the map, use a small flashlight and only look at the map briefly because you want to keep your eyes adapted to the dark. So now we're ready to use our star wheel. Let's say it will be a clear night on February 14th, and you want to view at 7 p.m. So we are going to look for 7 p.m. on the edge of our holder, and then turn our wheel or circular sky map until that white line above 7 p.m. points at February 14th. And these are the stars that you will see in the night sky that night. So if you're facing south, these stars will be along the horizon. These will be farther up. These stars will be directly overhead. But we want to see the Big Dipper. Can you find it on the star map? It's near the upper edge of the oval. So what do we need to do to be able to see the Big Dipper? If you said we need to turn and face north, you're right. So we'll turn our sky wheel So it says facing north. And now we should be able to see the Big Dipper. Look for those two pointer stars and follow them over to the North Star. Now you can find the Big Dipper and the North Star in the night sky. You can set your star wheel to any date and time to see what constellations will be in the sky that night.
Even though it may seem that we can see lots of stars on a clear night, we do not see all the stars that are visible to us. City lights prevent us from seeing some of the stars. This is called light pollution. Street lights, lights in parking lots, and even the lights on the outside of our homes. Wash the light out from stars, and only a few stars can be seen in the sky. When light pollution is reduced, many more stars are visible. When we look at the night sky using our eyes, we can only see a limited number of stars. To view stars more closely, we could use binoculars or a small telescope. Light telescopes collect as much light as possible from objects, like stars. This makes it easier for us to view the night sky. But when scientists want to study stars, not just the ones closest to Earth, but stars that are far into space, they must use very large telescopes. Telescopes so big that they need their own special building called an observatory. Some Fermilab scientists, together with other scientists from around the world, used a very large telescope at the Cerro Tololo Inter-American Observatory, which is situated on a mountaintop in Chile, a country in South America. Their study of outer space was called the Dark Energy Survey. The scientists wanted to learn why the universe seems to be expanding faster and faster. This is a photo of the observatory site. The largest building in the center is the observatory, which houses a large telescope called the Blanco Telescope. And look at the amazing night sky over the observatory. This is a sketch of the Blanco telescope inside the observatory. By comparing its size to the size of the people in the red circle, you can see just how big the Blanco telescope is. The scientists wanted to be able to take photos of what the telescope was viewing, so a special camera had to be designed to fit exactly on the Blanco telescope. This special camera, called the Dark Energy Camera, or DCAM for short, was assembled and tested at Fermilab. Here are two scientists checking the Dark Energy Camera. And here is the camera fully assembled. All the blue rectangles you see in the center make this an extremely powerful digital camera. This camera can stare at the sky for a long time and store lots of light. It was able to take very clear photos of galaxies, enormous groups of stars, 48 trillion miles away. That's 48 with 12 zeros. That's really far. Inside the black cylinder is the Dark Energy Camera, which is mounted on the Blanco telescope. The curved roof, called a dome, is open for viewing the night sky. Scientists from all over the world use the Dark Energy Camera to learn more about our universe. Most large telescopes, like the Blanco telescope, are located high on mountaintops. But this telescope is located in a very special place, the South Pole. Here are some Fermilab scientists who use this telescope to learn how the universe began. Hopefully, you are now anxious to tour the night sky. As you look up, maybe you will see your own patterns in the stars and create your own star stories. And perhaps you are filled with curiosity about stars and our universe.
Thank you, Julie, for that wonderful presentation on stargazing. Now we're going to turn it over to Donna Kubik, who is going to tell us about her adventures in the South Pole building a telescope. Take it away, Donna.
Good morning, everyone. I'm very happy to be able to share with you some of my experiences working at the South Pole. This is my globe, which you might think looks a little odd because everything's upside down. And that's because I love the South Pole so much, I flip my globe around so that Antarctica is at the top, so it's easier to see. So to get to Antarctica, you have to travel quite a long ways. From Chicago, you have to fly to New Zealand, and then from New Zealand, you take another plane to the coast of Antarctica, and then you take another plane to the South Pole itself. So I'll show you some pictures and tell you a little more about how you travel to the South Pole and what it's like working at the South Pole. So light from the first moments after the Big Bang is still traveling across the universe, and we call that light the cosmic microwave background. And we've built a camera and a telescope that are sensitive enough to detect this light. On the right, you'll see the camera as it looked when it was at Fermilab as we were building it and testing it. And on the left is the detector array that detects the cosmic microwave background. A little later, you'll see the same camera and the same detectors at the South Pole. Since we're detecting microwaves and not optical light, so you can't see microwaves with your eyes, we needed to build a different kind of sensor than an optical imager. We needed to design these arrays of superconducting microwave antennas. So detector consists of an array of 10 wafers like this. And if you got me for a second, here's what the wafer looks like. Not just a picture, but with me. So we made a camera out of 10 of these arrays of microwave antennas. And then we installed them on the South Pole telescope. So the South Pole, when you're at the South Pole, the telescope is just a short walk from the geographic South Pole. But the South Pole actually moves as 10 meters per year because it's located on an ice sheet that's constantly moving. So every year there's a ceremony where we move the pole at marker back to the right place so that it's really at the axis of rotation. And that's the only instant when it's actually exactly at the right place. So the South Pole is a great place to study microwaves. It's located 2,800 meters above sea level, where it's very high and dry and cold. And the reason that's important, especially the dry part, is that microwaves are absorbed by water in the atmosphere. And it's so cold at the South Pole that all the water freezes out, which provides a clear path for the microwaves, which have been traveling for nearly 14 billion years to get to our telescope. So how cold is it? Well, here you see the highest recorded temperature, which is actually sort of Chicago winter temperatures, but the lowest reported temperature is minus 117 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's super cold. And one thing I like about this picture is not just that this person is so bundled up that you can't even recognize whoever they are, but the shadows are very long and low, and they're like that all the time, 24 hours a day, because at the South Pole, it's either daylight 24 hours a day for half a year, or it's dark for 24 hours a day for half a year, because you're lower, you're beneath the Arctic Circle. And the sun never gets higher than 23 degrees above the horizon. So the sun's always low, so your shadow always looks kind of long and skinny. The only time you can actually go to the South Pole is from around November, December, January, and February of each year, because that's when it's summer at the South Pole. The rest of the time, it's too cold for planes to land at the South Pole. And that's when it's daylight. And then here you see the sun's getting lower and lower and lower, and then it sets and it's just beneath the horizon, resulting in quite stable temperatures throughout the austral winter. And then here the sun will rise very quickly. And here the sun is now above the horizon for the summertime. So how do you get to the South Pole? What is that? So you take a commercial flight, a 19-hour commercial flight from Chicago to the U.S. Antarctic Program base, which is in Christchurch, New Zealand. And the first place you always go to is the Clothing Distribution Center, which is the home of Big Red. So it's this gigantic warehouse of these Big Red down coats, and then the Antarctic Program also provides all the other gear you need in these big orange bags, because they want to be very sure that you have all the warm clothing you need with you before you're allowed to even step on the plane to fly to the South Pole. So you don't need to bring any of your own warm clothing. In fact, it's summer in New Zealand at this time, so it's actually quite warm, so that's nice. And I'm going to show you, I have one of these orange bags that you carry with you on the plane with all your stuff in it, and they give you giant boots and goggles and mittens, and I'm gonna put on, show you. They're super warm, and see it has my name on it. And that's because everybody has their name on their coat. Because when you're walking around outside, you look like this, like that guy in the picture. And you really often can't recognize people, even your friends and your colleagues. And I found myself looking at their name tag more than once when I was at the South Pole. So once you have all your gear, you board a C-130 aircraft. This is a plane with four giant propellers to fly to Antarctica. And that C in its name stands for cargo, which will become apparent why in a second. So the flight is, you get on the plane in New Zealand and you drive for 7 hours across the ocean to McMurdo, which is a US Antarctic base on the coast of New Zealand. And then you'll get on another plane, fly to the South Pole. So here we are flying to McMurdo, and it's really comfy, and you can see this girl has her Big Red with her, and it's warm enough on the plane that she took it off and tucked it into this netting. And the passengers, we sit along the side of the fuselage, and all of the cargo is everywhere else on the plane. It's really hard to walk around the plane. It's so crowded. And everything has to get to Antarctica on these planes, which includes the detectors for our telescope, the receiver, food, everything has to go on these planes to Antarctica along with the people. So, but it's cozy, it's really fun, it's really, really loud because those propellers are super loud. So you don't think, oh, do I really need to use earplugs? I don't like them so much. You wouldn't even question it. You would absolutely wear earplugs because it's so loud and you can barely talk to people. So after 7 hours in the air, we landed in McMurdo, and that airfield is right, has a clear view of the famous volcano, Mount Erebus, which is an active volcano. So these aren't clouds. This is steam or smoke, kind of steam coming out of the volcano. You always see that on the top of Mount Erebus. And in McMurdo, which is, again, is on the coast, that's where in the summer, again, only in the summer, the ocean giant brings supplies and takes away waste from the entire continent. So you don't ever leave anything, any waste of any kind there. It's taken away on the ocean giant. And it can also bring supplies. I did say everything has to come on the plane. Maybe not quite everything, but a lot of stuff comes on the planes. But the ocean giant can also bring supplies. And the ocean giant can't get in until the polar star, the icebreaker, makes a path for it to get into McMurdo. This town looks like an old mining town. Sometimes it looks like this, quite barren, at the beginning of, like, in the early part of the season. But I've been there twice, and the other time I was there, there was actually more snow on the ground. And it does look like an old mining town. And this church here, when I first got to the town, everything was kind of the same. So I could recognize the church, so I kind of used it as a landmark. And it's really cute. It's called Chapel of the Snows. It's the world's southernmost house of worship. And when you go inside, there are these windows with, very fortunately, some binoculars that are always there. And because you really want to look out the window at the ice sheet, because you can see seals basking in the sun and sometimes baby seals. It's really cool. So it's very nice that they have these binoculars in the church. And the stained glass has this really cool artwork of an outline of Antarctica with a penguin. And even the cross has an outline of Antarctica behind it. So usually you stay in McMurdo for a day or two before you get another plane to fly to the South Pole. And to get to the South Pole from McMurdo, so you're going from here, from the coast, over the Transantarctic mountain range to the South Pole, which is in the middle of the continent. So it's flying over the mountains. It's, as you look out those portholes in the plane, it's mile after mile of snow and glaciers and more glaciers and more snow and more glaciers. And then you arrive at the South Pole. And the plane lands on, not on the runway, we call it the skiway, because the plane lands on skis. You can see these skis. And after the plane lands, the skis are raised up a bit off of the snow and ice so that they don't get stuck or frozen to the ice. So this is a very typical scene at the South. The place you live is called the station, and it's very comfortable to live there. I will show you what it looks like inside. And it's shaped like an airfoil. You can see that this part is skinnier and then it gets thicker this way. And the prevailing winds come from this direction. So it's like, this is the leading edge of the airfoil. And the reason it was designed that way is a big problem with any buildings at the South Pole is that they get buried in drifting snow. They just always are getting buried. And this wind almost always blows from the same direction. There's very, very definite prevailing wind direction. So by building this direction, this building, so that this is pointing toward the prevailing wind, the wind gets accelerated under the airfoil and kind of sweeps out snow from beneath and deposits it downwind after the building. So far it's been working out quite well. This building is not quite 10 years old now. The older places that you used to live, there is a famous dome that used to be at the South Pole, is buried now. So So this is working quite well. And if this the snow does get too deep, all of these legs can be jacked up so they're movable. So inside the station, everyone has their own tiny room, but really comfortable room. You have a bunk and area underneath it to store all your personal items, a place to plug in your laptop. It's really comfortable. There's a library, and there's even a little gym where you can go and work out. There's a cafeteria with a nice galley where you eat, and there are these monitors, TV monitors, that post all of, like, the local happenings. Maybe they're going to show a movie in the station one night, and it always shows the weather. So this is what was on one of the monitors one of the days I was there. So it says that, again, this is summer at the South Pole. The temperature is going to be about minus 27 degrees Fahrenheit. But like Chicago, there's at the South Pole, always the wind chill. And so it would feel like minus 52 degrees. So this is what the commute to work looks like. So imagine yourself at the station, and now you're going to walk to work. And to me, work was walking to the South Pole telescope, which you see here in the distance. And this was always my very, very, very favorite thing to do when I was at the South Pole, maybe my favorite thing to do ever, because you're alone and you have a little time to think. When you're at the South Pole, you're only there for, depending on your job, for a few weeks or a couple months. There's a fixed amount of time to do the job and to put all of the parts of the telescope and the receiver and the camera together before that last plane leaves. So you don't have very much time. So you're super busy. But on this, when you're walking from the station to the telescope, you have time to just sit back and look around and say, oh my gosh, I'm at the South Pole. And I just still can't believe I've been at the South Pole. And you just look and it's just white from horizon to horizon. And I just would always say, I don't know how I got to be so lucky, because I'm just this kid from Chicago and I grew up and actually had this opportunity to work at the South Pole. So I'm very thankful and it's so much fun. So here you go, and then you get to the South Pole telescope. So then what do? So this part is the laboratory, and I'm going to show you a video of what it looks like in here. This is a neighboring telescope called BICEP. This is our telescope called the South Pole Telescope. And in the video, you'll see us putting together the camera. We'll be here, and we're going to roll it into here and put it in the receiver, which is the camera that has the long cylindrical optics tube that you saw earlier, and you'll see it again here. And we're going to put that whole camera in here, which then will receive the microwaves from the sky that reflect off this 10-meter telescope into the receiver. And then we record by detecting that light that's exciting a signal on all those superconducting antennas in the array. And we study the microwave background to learn about the physics of the early universe. So I will now show you the video. You can see what it looks like inside our laboratory. Thank you. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that trip to the South Pole.
Thank you so much, Donna. That was really fascinating. I have a bunch of questions here that have popped up. The first one is, how do they keep the equipment from freezing up at the South Pole?
Well, it does freeze because it is, some of it, I mean, the telescope itself is cold, but we do have heaters in the laboratories that we're working on. And I didn't really stress this, but our antennas, the receiver, those superconducting antennas actually operate at just a little bit above absolute zero at 250 millikelvins. So those are really, really cold. So it's not a huge, huge problem that it's cold.
And Chris asks, is it unhealthy to be in darkness for 6 months?
I don't think so. I know many people who we leave people. There are people there during that 6 months when it's dark. So there's a crew of 25 people there about every winter. And for our telescope, we have two people that are taking care of our telescope. The other telescope I showed you has a couple people, and there are other experiments at the South Pole that have a few people, and then you have a doctor and machinists and people to maintain the motor generators that generate the power. And very importantly, there are the cooks in the cafeteria. So there are about 25 people. And they seem to fare quite well and are quite busy during the winter at the South Pole. So I don't think it would be dangerous. I would love to spend the winter there.
And obviously, there is a comment in here about how enthusiastic you are and how much passion you're showing for this. So, and I would agree with that. Do people from every country go visit, and do you need translators?
At the South Pole Station is a United States base. Most everybody speaks English at the South Pole Station, but there are many other stations in Antarctica that are operated by other countries, by Argentina and China, and I don't know what they all are, but they're far apart from each other, so that we don't visit each other at all because it's really far apart. So there, I would assume they speak different languages. But at the South Pole, everybody speaks English, but there is an international contingent. Like for the South Pole Telescope Group, we have grad students and collaborators from other countries, but everybody speaks English at the South Pole.
Does anyone ever get lost walking around, or do you always walk with someone?
We don't have a rule in the summer that you have to walk with someone, and only a couple times did I feel like I wanted to be sure I was with someone. If the wind was blowing a lot and there was a lot of snow, if there's a time when you can't see the telescope from the station or vice versa, when you're going to walk back to the station, if you can't see the station, it's a little scary. But the way that you find your way is along the path. There are many flags that mark the trail. You know, it's colored flags that you can see and you can hear. And in the winter, I'm told they multiply the number of flags by 10. Because then in the winter, it's much more likely that there would be limited visibility at the South Pole. So that didn't quite answer your question. I don't think anyone's ever gotten lost, but I think in the winter, it's more of a danger because then you can have, you know, bigger, higher winds and more snow blowing around and things like that.
And less light.
And less light, yeah. So you have those flags, and people who have spent the winter at the South Pole said that you usually use those flags by ear, not by eye. it's actually useful to hear the flapping because it's always, the wind's always blowing. So you, even in the summer, I can remember hearing the flapping of the flags all the time.
And how did you get chosen to work on the telescope and go to the South Pole?
Here at Fermilab, my job was assembling the wafers that I showed you, like getting these from that are made at Argonne National Laboratory, and we would then bring them to Fermilab and put them together like you saw us assembling them in that time lapse of the South Pole to test them here, to put them in a holder and connect, wire bound them and connect all the electronics. So I did that for several years at Fermilab, and we needed to do that again at the South Pole. So I was lucky just that I had experience doing that and with some of my colleagues. So I got to carry the detectors and then kind of reassemble things and check things out at the South Pole.
Can snow interfere with the reflector?
Not too much. And it actually, surprisingly, doesn't snow that much at the South Pole. It more blows a lot. And whenever it does snow, the snow never leaves, which is why there are, you know, the ice, everything is built up to be so deep. But it doesn't interfere a lot. It can, if it's not, the sky's not always perfectly clear. It is high and dry and cold, but there are clouds. And when it is cloudy, you can see that in the data. So we keep very, very good weather records. And then if the data looks a little iffy, we say, oh, what was the weather like? And like, oh, that makes sense that the data's not as good. So the weather is important, but the weather's often very good, especially in the winter. It's so cold. And it's also, another good thing about being at the South Pole, whether it's summer or winter, is that there's no diurnal heating and cooling. So it's pretty much always the same temperature. And that's not true of telescopes in other parts of the world where they cool off in the evening and then you have to wait for things to get thermally equilibrated. That's an advantage being at the South Pole, that the temperature is pretty stable all the time.
Is there any tourism? So could someone come and have a tour of your laboratory, or is there tourism at the Antarctic?
There is some, not not through the scientists, not through us, but some private companies, when I was there, have gotten the permission to land some planes there. So there are very few, but there are tourists there. I think there are more tourists on the coast of Antarctica that come in ships. So it's, but at the South Pole, it's very limited because it's a long way from the coast, and it would be very expensive and to
very remote.
Very, very, very remote. So the answer is yes, but it's not common at all, really. The gross majority of people there are scientists working on different projects.
And also, we do have a full video on our website to see the step-by-step directions to build the Constellation Viewer and Star Wheel. And that was put into the chat just for those who are interested in that. We're getting towards the end of our time. There is another question here. How long can a person stay outside in that gear? How long can you stay outside in the gear that you had, like the jacket and gloves?
You could stay up for many hours. I don't really know. I don't know the answer to that, but you're pretty warm, and depending on if you can block yourself from the wind, you have a lot of warm clothes. And in the summer, it's much, much warmer relative to the winter. So I think in the winter, the people really do have to limit the time that they're outside. But while it's cold, it can be out pretty long. Although job, I wasn't outside that much. But,
you were in the lab working and building things and get every, yeah.
Yeah, but some people have to work outside. Like there are carpenters and people who are driving tractors to move the snow around a little. And so there are outdoor jobs, but mine was not.
Do the other countries share technical information direct or indirectly with each other?
For scientists at the South.
Like your data, does that get shared with?
Oh, yeah. And
I think that's what Chris is getting at. Do the other countries share technical information directly or indirectly with each other?
I would say yes. There are many other experiments that are other telescopes that are studying the cosmic microwave background. For example, the one that I said is our neighbor at the South Pole. And there are several telescopes in the Atacama Desert in Chile, which is also high and dry and cold, almost as good as the South Pole. And we do share data and results and combine results with them. We also kind of work with data from the space-based telescope called Planck, which is studying the cosmic microwave background. And all of these different telescopes have their own strengths to study different aspects, you know, either having a deeper view of the microwave background, higher resolution, lower resolution, all different aspects, different frequency bands. And it is good to combine that information. So yes, we do all work together.
And what's the latest info you got from the telescope?
Well, there's so many recent results. In the data, we also find things in addition to studying the cosmic microwave background. We also can detect things like asteroids, and we also can detect galaxies. So in that case, we work with other telescopes, like the one that Julie was telling about, the Dark Energy Survey. We observe the same part of the sky, so we can observe and detect galaxies that they maybe would miss, but then they can go back and look at them and get good redshift information to get more information about the expansion of the universe. But the thing that sort of the holy grail of the microwave background studies that we want to detect, that we nor and none of the other telescopes have detected yet, is a signal that would tell us that early in the universe, there was a period called inflation, in which the universe expanded super fast. And that would be evidenced by a certain pattern in the polarization of the microwave. So our detectors do detect the polarization, but the signals, the polarization signal, is much fainter than the non-polarized signal. So that we have not detected, and that is what we are hoping to detect soon. So, and as is also true of the other experiment.
And unfortunately, we are out of time, but thank you so much. If anybody wants more information, go to our website, fnal.gov. There's a ton of information there. Check out other activities at our open house. And thank you so much for participating in this classroom presentation.
Thank you.